Hello learners, today we are going to talk about livelihoods and what makes livelihoods sustainable. Livelihoods is really about making a living. What are the resources that people have and how do they use them, not just for everyday coping, but also in terms of meeting their medium-term and long-term goals. So if we get started with the lecture, we will really look at these pictures. It's about making incomes. Last week, when I spoke about sustainable food systems and sustainable development, very important part of it was production, was earning incomes. So that's the first part, really, of the food systems, that you have to have a livelihood which provides you the resources to lead the kind of life that you want. So we have two main objectives we will be looking at today. First is to develop a theoretical understanding of what are the factors that shape people's livelihood strategies and also outcomes. And second, to understand the role of the larger policy and institutional context in shaping individual, household, and community level vulnerabilities. There are different definitions of livelihoods. So two important ones which I would like to share with you, which are very basic but which are very fundamental to our understanding of livelihoods. The first, by Chambers and Conway, which talks about livelihood as comprising people have to be at the heart of it, their capabilities or capacities and their means of living. What are the resources they have to make a living? And these could include the food, very central to their lives, income and assets. Do they have energy? Are they weak? Are they able to work? The second aspect or definition, very similar in nature, is from Frank Ellis, who talks about livelihood comprising the assets, the activities, and the access to these, mediated by policies and institutions that together determine the living gained by the individual or household. So the policies and institutions are really the politics, the larger context in which people live and in which people have the ability or not to use certain resources in particular ways. So translating this definition of Ellis into a very simple framework, in the center you have assets, activities and outcomes as a chain. Depending on the resources you have, you can do certain things and that leads to certain outcomes. But these are not in isolation. These are located within a context of vulnerability which people face. We spoke about the various drivers of food systems, the risks in terms of climatic risks, natural degradation, floods, droughts, seasonality, price volatility, shifts in prices, other kinds of shocks that people may confront. And also, at the same time, there is the policy and the institutional context. What are the framework for rights? What kinds of social relations? Women, for instance, can they do the same tasks as men, or are they debarred from doing certain activities? What does the governance system look like? Is there a local government which is supportive of people and what they want to do? Now, it's a very similar thing. As I said, Ian Schoons, he has develops this framework, very simple framework, including examples of these different elements. So within the vulnerability, as I mentioned already, he mentions history, politics, the terms of trade, climate, demography, social differentiation, gender, and so on. Then within assets, he calls them the capitals, and he says that there is natural capital, which is your land, water, soil. There is financial capital or money. What is the money that you have? What are the economic resources that you have in order to make a living? Then human capital. Human capital refers to ourselves and our bodies. What kind of skills do we have? What kind of education do we have? How is our health? Do we have a disability? These are very important elements of human capital. Social capital is what are our connections, what are our social networks? Do we know somebody in the government who can help us, you know, with some resources or with some training and so on and so forth? The third box for him is also the policy and institutional context, which includes a range of institutions, as I already gave some examples. These could be community level institutions like caste or ethnicity, tribe or gender at the household level, or they could be government organizations, non-government organizations, and so on. depending on the assets that people have and the context in which they are in. And mediated by these institutions, you can engage in a range of activities, what has also been called as livelihood strategies by Schoons. So he classifies these activities into three parts. One is within agriculture itself. You either cultivate more and more land, so you intensify agriculture, extensify agriculture, or intensify, that is the same plot of land you use for multiple crops, you increase crop diversity, seasonally you grow different kinds of crops, and so on. The second is livelihood diversification, that apart from agriculture, you're also looking for other kinds of non-farm and off-farm activities. So you may set up a little shop, or you may learn some other skill and do some other work part-time, and so on. A lot of women, for instance, in North India, they do beedi rolling. So they may have small farms where they are cultivating, but they also roll beedis at home, or they do zari work, or they do bead work, and so on. This is as an extra source of income, diversification. And the third is migration. As I showed you in the beginning, if there is no options locally to diversify out of agriculture, then you have to move physically to some other location where you're able to find work. It could be a city, it could be a rural area, a construction site, a brick kiln, and so on. And finally, you have all this, your strategies, your activities lead to particular outcomes. So on the one hand, in terms of livelihood outcomes, it could be more number of working days, you reduce poverty, earn more incomes, your well-being improves, and so on, you learn more skills, and so on. And also, from a sustainability lens, also there are outcomes. So how do you reduce your vulnerability and enhance your resilience to these shocks? And also, how do you use your natural resource base much more sustainably? So this is an elaboration of a very simple framework from Frank Ellis that I showed you. Now I will look at each of these in little bit more detail. In terms of the context, we examined many of these contextual variables when we were looking at drivers of sustainable development or drivers of sustainable food systems. So I will now start with looking at some of the assets. So as I said, these are the categories of natural capital, human capital, physical capital, and so on. So these include land, livestock. Human capital is our labor and how skilled or good our labor is. It includes education. Physical capital includes also tools, implements. Do I have a tractor? Do I have other kinds of technology like an LPG stove to help me with my tasks? Financial capital could be savings, loans, and so on. And social capital, as I said, could be your networks. So in the following lectures on this topic of livelihoods, you will hear more in detail about social and cultural capital, as well as natural and human capital from my colleagues. So this is an example of how the kind of assets that you have can make a difference in terms of your outcomes. If you remember when we were talking in the first block on participatory approaches, I had said that one of the tools for participatory approaches is ranking. So here it is ranking by assets, wealth ranking by assets. When you're measuring people as rich, medium, poor, by the kind of assets that they have. And then on the in the columns, we are looking at the different kinds of assets that they have and how that contributes actually to their livelihood outcome. So if somebody, for instance, has land, if he has a large khet or a large piece of land, then they may be quite food secure. They have enough food, sufficient land to feed the family. And they may also have surplus, they may be able to sell. For somebody who is poor, they may have little land, maybe only a small plot of land. This may not be sufficient to feed the family. And therefore, it shapes what kinds of activities they can undertake. They may have to go for wage labor, they may have to migrate, and so on. So I think this way, we can look at the different assets people have, or livestock that they have, or their own bodies, their services, laboring bodies, and how then this can contribute to the livelihood strategies as well as to the livelihood outcomes. So if we come back to the framework, we look at the next element, that is activities. Having looked at assets, as I said, you will discuss assets in a little more detail in the coming sessions. So I will focus on the activities and the outcomes. This is an example taken from Frank Ellis of an income portfolio. So we engage in various activities basically to generate some kind of incomes, whether it is as subsistence through food or cash crops or through other kinds of activities. So here he shows typically that people have a diverse portfolio of activities. Nobody is dependent on only one aspect. So even if people are growing food crops, for instance, in this diagram, 25% of your land may be used for food crops, but you will still grow cash crops on some land, maybe some fodder crops for livestock. Some member of the family may go for wage income, for business, some may migrate. When I was doing work in India, but also in Kenya, I found that in every household, there are people are doing different activities. So from the same family, you know, one or two sons or daughters may be educated and may go for government jobs. Somebody is looking after the livestock, somebody is looking after the farming, and so on. So typically, there is quite a diverse portfolio of incomes. So in a study of 310 households in 9 villages in Tanzania, Ellis, however, found that there is quite a significant difference between the top quartile and the bottom quartile. That is the richest 25% and the poorest 25%. Now, this is something I also showed you in the wealth ranking. So in the top 25%, the pie chart at the bottom, you see that 44% of their income comes from non-farm income. So this may be some kind of business. They might have set up a petrol pump, a shop, a restaurant, or whatever it is. Whereas for the bottom 25%. They do not have the economic capital, they do not have the resources to diversify into non-farm incomes. Only 11% of their income comes from non-farm. And in fact, 27% maize, which is here the basic staple food crop, like rice and wheat in India, contributes a substantial chunk of their income portfolio. So I think we always need to remember that people are not homogeneous. We are differentiated by our income categories, by the resource that we have, by gender. So women, for instance, even in these households, even in the landed households, their situation or ability to raise income might be much less because they may not have land at their disposal. Now, why is this diversity of income sources or this multiple activities important for households? The first thing is about reducing risk and reducing vulnerability. As I said, supposing you're only dependent on farming and there is a cyclonic storm or there is a flood, then everything is gone. But if you have been able, or drought, if you have been able to diversify, then it reduces your risk somewhat. It also smooths seasonality in terms of food, labor, and incomes. So typically we know that in agriculture, for instance, paddy, we grow it now in June, July, the paddy is planted, then it is harvested by October, November. So in between, from July to November, you won't have any source of food. So this is where having an extra outside source of income is very helpful to help you smooth over this period, to help you consume over this period till you get the harvest and your food drains are full. In fact, when I was working in Dumka, the people would always tell me that the monsoon season or the rainy season was the period of hardest work, but it was also the period of hunger when there was no food to eat. Third, it increases your options for generating cash. And in today's time, it's not just food that people need, but they need cash for many purposes, for educating their children, for health expenses, and so on. And also the potential to enable accumulation. That you want to save money, so you want to improve in the future. Now, all parents feel that our children should be better than we are. Therefore, they try to save money, they try to buy assets, they try to expand their resource base so that the next generation does better. And here it's important to remember that activities, this is also because, you know, this is just an example that how to show the seasonality of activities. When we were talking about participatory approaches, I mentioned to you that seasonality and seasonal calendars is one tool which is often used. And here you see in this diagram, which is from Africa actually, from Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, that in this study they found that rice, for instance, in September, October, November, December, it was very limited. And the food availability, as I just mentioned in the case of Dumka, is also much lower during the monsoon period. So then we look finally at livelihood strategies. I have mentioned some of these just now, that one thing is for people who are very poor, it is really about somehow or the other coping, improve your security, day-to-day security under very much threatened conditions. And such people like widows, women-headed households, may often depend on the state, on social protection. They are very vulnerable. They don't have much assets and they really live from day to day. The second kind of strategy is what we call step up. So you're trying to improve. And this, as I said, as in Schoon's terms, there are three possible ways in which people have their strategies. One is intensification. So you seek to produce more from land, which is a key asset. So you may have a well or have a source of irrigation. Then you grow not just the monsoon crop or the rain-fed crop, but you take a second winter crop and potentially a third summer crop. Extensification, that you try to cultivate in more amount of land than what you have. You purchase more or you lease in more land. And then diversification of crops itself. So you have food crops, cash crops and so on. You can do value addition or you can do other kinds of income generation, like having a petty shop or having some kind of a enterprise or business. The third strategy is about what we call a stepping out. And this is really about migration. And here what we know is that people then become much more reliant on remittances. So many economies, like in Uttarakhand in India or in Nepal, now all the men, because of the harsh terrain, have migrated out to Delhi, to Bombay and to the plains. And therefore these economies, which are mainly women-based, are much more reliant on the income that the men send back home or take back home. And this is called as remittance, or the money that is remitted back, sent back to the home. But here, there are issues around assets and vulnerability of people, often women, who are left behind. As I just said, if the money doesn't come from the man, then the woman is really in a very vulnerable position. She has to take loans from the local shopkeeper, borrow, or find ways of managing, also in the absence of the man. So without the labor of the man at hand, single-handedly, she has to manage. Other strategies can also be there. I had mentioned about collectives when we were talking about sustainable development, that this is an important strategy for challenging some of the, for facing or encountering some of the challenges that we face, like the Amul cooperatives, where they were made into group in order to be able to confront the power of big corporate enterprises. It can also include possibilities for value addition and going up the value chain. At present, the government in India is supporting the farmer producer organizations. It wants them to collectivize and then to add value to their produce in order to be able to get a better price for their commodities. So now we come back to the framework and we go to the next point, which is really about outcomes. There are two main categories of outcomes. So first, as I said, if you remember the diagram also, one is the outcomes for us as individuals, as people, for our standards of living, for our well-being. This will include the attainment of food security. You know, are we moving out of poverty into a non-poor category and so on? Or is our health improving? Is our educational status improving and so on? And the second one is about the sustainability of natural resources themselves. What is the outcome in terms of natural resources? And these different activities really imply that there are different outcomes depending on who we are. So these activities imply different kinds of pressures on both natural resources as well as on human beings and our own well-being. So we'll turn now really to the context in terms of vulnerability and what is the kind of vulnerabilities that people are facing and how do they actually then encounter these vulnerabilities? How do they strategize to move these vulnerabilities? So vulnerability typically refers to vulnerability to hunger, that is the gap between the ability to access food and what is the minimum consumption needs of the individual or the family. So this is a picture of a woman, in a very poor woman who is a widow and who is selling some poor quality fish near a harbour, on the outskirts of a harbour. She's not even able to make ends meet. So here she's really vulnerable. She doesn't have the resources to buy better quality of fish. She's too old to be able to go door to door or village to village to find better markets. And this really creates a gap in terms of how much is her consumption and what is her need. A second kind of element of vulnerability to understand is really as a relationship between the risk of an adverse effect event and the ability to deal with that event. So again, if I have some resources, then if, let's say, if there is a drought or if there is a flood and I have some savings or I have some grain stored up, then I'm better able to cope, or I have some seeds even, then I'm better able to cope with that situation and plant once that problem is solved. But if I don't have anything, then I get into a very vulnerable position because I don't have the capacity to confront that risk. So for high risk and adverse events, if you are unable to cope with it, then that means one is very highly vulnerable. And the kinds of shocks that you may face may be individual. So somebody dies. So this is a woman and her husband suddenly dies, let's say, or has an accident, or you lose an cattle, or you have to, because of an illness, you have to pledge your land. In the COVID pandemic, we have heard many stories like this, that a rickshaw puller got ill and they had to spend about 50,000 rupees in the hospital. And as a result, that family lost a lot of their savings or assets. So the shocks may be individual or the shocks may be collective, like droughts, floods, and so on. Now, what happens when we look at vulnerability as a sequence, as a risk sequence, that assets play a very important role in terms of managing that risk and coping. So if there is a shock and if you don't have assets, then actually you become more vulnerable, you become poorer, you become more destitute, your well-being is affected. If you have some level of assets, and as I said, the assets definition is wide, so it could also be social assets, like you have a very strong kin relationship or you have very strong family support who will help you out. That can also help with coping and risk management. So we then look at land use and vulnerability to hunger. And these are pictures that I have taken from Eastern India, from Odisha actually, from Koraput district. And here you see traditionally that, you know, you had these mixed forests, you had your paddy growing lands and so on. But now in the uplands, you can also see that some eucalyptus plantations have come up. And this has been to provide wood to the paper industry. Of course, what eucalyptus does is that it absorbs a lot of water, and if it's upstream, then you have less water downstream. It affects your cultivation, and those soils where eucalyptus is grown once, it becomes very difficult to grow other products there. Earlier, women used to use that land to cultivate millets, horse grams, vegetables, and so on. So when the land use pattern changes, you also become quite vulnerable if you don't have control over that land. So these eucalyptus plantations are not controlled by the local women. They are controlled actually because they cannot use that eucalyptus directly. They are very much dependent on the paper industry for that. So with vulnerability, the other things that we should see also is a timeline. That, and this can go either way. So where you have poor assets or networks and the state social support or state transfers are not strong enough, when there is an initial shock, you may recover partially. But if there's a next shock, then your ability to recover becomes weaker. In the next shock, you go further down. So sometimes vulnerability can keep increasing over time as people lose their assets. It can be the reverse also. That if you have few assets, if you diversify, if you're able to build your assets, then your vulnerability can keep reducing as well each time. So the final element I would like to talk about is the policy and institutional context. Unpacking policy and institutions. And here we really see that there are a couple of things that one would like to look at. One is the government. You know, how decentralized is it? How accessible is it to people? What is the quality of governance? Do people need to pay bribes or corruption for everything? What are the taxation policies? you know, are things which they need in their everyday life heavily taxed and so on. So we need to understand the whole framework of government and governance and how it affects people's abilities to take particular action. Second, very important, is the whole issue of authority, power, participation, ability to influence decisions. This is picture is from my work in Dumka. It's a court scene actually. And you can see the power differential between the lawyer sitting on his chair and table and the woman who has gone to ask for resolution of some problem in relation to her land. She is really sitting on the mud. So this is a very unequal power relations. How far the woman has to beg the lawyer. They are not on an equal relationship even though she is paying fees to the lawyer. So your ability to then make decisions really gets constrained. The third element in institutions is about social relations of gender. I just gave you an example of ethnicity, of tribes, of religion, of kinship. So tribal populations again in India are seen as quite marginalized because they live in these remote areas. They are seen as non-literate. They are seen as backward. Their habits and customs and norms are looked down upon and so on. And they also remain amongst the very poor in this country. So even if they have very strong social network, the ability to support each other may be much more limited than if you have people in better off, well off positions. Finally, rights are very important. As I talked about land use a minute ago, it is about property rights. It's also about the rights to commons and a wide variety of other human rights. So what has now happened with many of the tribal populations in India who used to get a lot of their food from forests? Because of various kinds of regulations of protection of forests and so on, these people are being kept out of the forest, which means they lack access also to the various fruits, greens, rabbits or birds which they used to hunt in the forest. So all these are affecting their livelihoods as well as their food consumption patterns. So finally, I would like to look at some of the emerging trends and what they contribute to livelihoods. So what about some of the emergence of new opportunities in the non-farm sector, both locally and non-locally? This has been a big pull factor for migration, for instance, that you have national policies of export-led development focused on manufacturing. You have infrastructure improvements so people can more easily travel to other parts of the country. You have education, which also supports such movement. In fact, in India, if we see now during the COVID pandemic, that lot of the labor which came from Eastern India, from West Bengal, from Bihar, from Jharkhand, from Odisha, they were stuck in Kerala, Tamil Nadu, Maharashtra, Karnataka. So clearly these areas, because of certain kinds of development, have provided more opportunities for jobs. The second thing is that farming and agriculture, smallholder agriculture, there has really been an erosion of profitability and returns to smallholder agriculture. I had mentioned when talking about sustainable food systems that, you know, very important to give a remunerative price. There should be profitability of farming. If this is not there, if our national policies have favored industry or the corporates, then farming naturally suffers. And India, we have seen a declining terms of trade between the non-farm sector and the farm sector. So one of the estimates is that at the time of independence, maybe a farmer earned 1/10 of an industrialist or any other person or a service sector person. But today it is like 1 to 100 is the gap between farm and non-farm income. So nobody wants to stay in farming. The young people don't want to stay in farming. The third is about environmental degradation also. That over time, because of overcropping, overgrazing, other non-sustainable practices, deforestation, overuse of chemicals and fertilizers, conflicts, that actually the environment has got degraded and people have no option but to move out. There's also shortages of land because of population growth. From the time of independence till now, our population has expanded at least 3 times. It is the same amount of land that is available. So how can more and more people be accommodated on that same amount of land. There is also resource constraint in terms of other resources. Though our productivity has gone up, I must say it is supporting more people, but this is not tenable. People have to diversify into other kinds of things. Water has become a point of conflict, but also water crunch or water grabbing or water shortages are increasing by the day. Finally, you also have cultural and social factors. So people want to go to cities, to urbanization. There is a lot of consumerism which has been pushed by the media, also education. So I want to conclude with just a few points on what does such an approach in terms of a livelihood approach help us in order to understand our production systems, understand people and their lives and how they are making a living and how we can actually support them. So I think the big benefit of a livelihood approach is that it asks questions about the blockages to building improved livelihoods. Where are the constraints? And if we can find the problems, if we can find the constraints, then we can also pay attention to removal of such constraints, to moving ahead in order to give people greater scope to construct their own roots out of poverty. So it's a more positive approach to identify what the poor have and then what, rather than what they do not have, and how do we strengthen people's own solutions rather than substitute for, block or undermine them. So I would like to just summarize by saying that the livelihoods approach to me is a very helpful approach because it is a people-focused approach. It recognizes rural people are not just farmers, but they are engaged in a plurality of activities, in diverse activities. And we need to understand why they are making these choices and support them in overcoming the barriers and the problems that they feel. Because it starts with people, it is also participatory in nature because it finds out from people what their problems and constraints are, what their needs and priorities are, and also what solutions they have been trying and how these can be strengthened with research, with investment, and so on. It focuses on the poor. As I've discussed a lot in this lecture, it focuses on understanding vulnerability, the causes, the risks that people encounter, and what makes them really subject to risk. What are the blockages and how can they be helped to overcome these vulnerabilities? It also focuses on the role of a range of assets in vulnerability and coping, livelihood strategies and sustainable resource management. So learners, I would like to stop at this point, but if you have any questions or comments, please do place them in the discussion forum. I think in this course, the next coming sessions will clarify much more on the role of assets as very critical in terms of building people's livelihoods. This points us also to the role of social difference, to inequality, whether it is between castes, whether it is between rich and poor, whether it is between urban and rural, whether it is between men and women, because their access to assets is different. And this really shapes their choices and their abilities to cope, and in short, the livelihood strategies that they are able to take up. Thank you, listeners, and see you next time.